work.
Thank you so much, Eve. Thanks for the kind words, the endorsement, and for the continued partnership. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be here. We would obviously much prefer that everyone who's watching today would be here in Israel to see things live up close, and to develop a relationship with not only with the people who are out there doing what we do, but also with the places and the huge history and the rich heritage that is part of our work together and separately as the two organizations move forward. Before I give you a very quick description of what Regovim does, I just wanted to mention another very tragic loss that the Jewish community has suffered over the last 24 hours. A great Zionist, many of you may have been familiar with his work on the Nachum Segal Network. I'm speaking of Meir Weingarten, who tragically passed away. Meir Weingarten, aside from being an avid Zionist and a tremendous source of information for the Jewish community outside of Israel, who was very, very connected to Israel. He's actually a grandson of Chief Rabbi Rav Uziel, wow. He's named for him. Fantastic, rich family history here in Israel and throughout the Jewish world, half Ashkenazi, half Sephardi, an illustrious and important family. The mayor will be sorely missed, both within Regavim, because he was a very strong supporter of our work, and I think in the broader Jewish community as well. So that being said, I'd like to try to keep him in mind. I think that the topic of tonight's lecture would have been very dear to his heart. So I'll tell you a little bit about Regavim. I'm going to share my screen just so that you can
pull away from the Western Wall, from the Kotel, which hasn't seen a crowd like that in a long time.
This is a pre-COVID photo, so we're more careful. But I'm going to just show you some pictures, and hopefully, here we are. Let's see. There, you should be seeing my screen. Mm-hmm. This is a scenery, some scenery that you'll enjoy, but also some very, very depressing photos, which I think will bring the point that I'm trying to make this evening home. At the end of this presentation, I'm going to give Eve a quiz. This is a tour guide's test, so she can identify all these places. I'm just kidding. We have some, as those of you who have been to Israel know, we have the most beautiful homeland in the world. There's nothing like it. And we try to keep it that way. So that's really what Regavim is about. We try to preserve Israel's resources, most particularly land resources. But the larger picture, and I think that that's what really connects to the events of these past 2 weeks, the larger picture is that the question of who uses the land of Israel, how they use it, what they use it for, who decides, who's in charge, is really the most basic expression of Jewish sovereignty. And so we become involved through the issue of land use and land use policy and enforcement of land use laws. We become involved very, very, very deeply in the question of Jewish sovereignty in the land of Israel as a whole, in Yehuda and Shomron, but everywhere else. We are active throughout the land of Israel, from the north to the south, in the Negev, in the Galilee. And some of the things that I will show you this evening will give you an idea about how involved we are in those places.
So let me just to fill in some of our listeners. So a few months ago, maybe even close to a year ago, when sovereignty was on the table, sovereignty of Judea and Samaria, and some of our guests that we have that we had on, Avi Bell and others, were really experts in the legal aspect of it. And one of the points that they made is that, you know, it's not just a matter of the ideological or the biblical connection to the land, but as you're about to show us, it's how the resources are used. If Israel is not sovereign in Judea and Samaria, that means the Western laws and codes upon which Israel rests, water usage, land usage, what you do with archaeological sites, what normal Western countries, the laws they have in place, are not really in place in Judea and Samaria. And therefore, the damage that is done is incalculable, but also we don't have a way to enforce, or do we have a way to enforce, Naomi, despite not being sovereign in Judea and Samaria?
So we have a way to enforce. It is an imperfect way. It is certainly lacking, but it exists. The question is whether we have the will to use the tools that are at our disposal. And unfortunately, we have found that the state of Israel, the government of Israel, is not necessarily aware, not necessarily willing, and unfortunately recently also not necessarily able to address the holes in the system. To fix them, that's a long shot, but to even use the tools that are available, the state of Israel has failed and is failing, which is why Regovim exists. We try to spotlight those issues. We try to spotlight the places where the holes in the system are allowing, first of all, the undermining of Israeli sovereignty and the destruction, really, of our homeland in a lot of ways. The complete destruction of a lot of Israel's natural resources and natural beauty, the erasure of Jewish history, and the creation of a hostile enemy state within the borders of the land of Israel. And we're going to look at some of those things this evening. Yeah. So we are a research-based organization. We start with fieldwork. Everything that we do starts out in the field, literally boots on the ground throughout Israel, going out every day to see what's out there, to document what's happening, who's doing what, and with what permission. And then we take a step back and we look at the changes on the ground to try to discern any sort of larger pattern, some picture, to try to figure out really if there's a guiding hand and what it all means for our present and future in this country. So we do what we do using regular documentation techniques. That means observation, taking pictures, using drones, purchasing GIS, meaning satellite images of the entire country, to compare them so that we can see what changes are happening on the ground. And then we analyze that whole picture. We take the whole thing back, we see what the changes are. And once we do, we try to figure out whether this is something that needs to be addressed, how to address it, and to what end. So let me go back again, and I'll just give you I want to explain how all of this has come to a head really in recent weeks. Many of you have been following the news, I assume with as much concern as we do. There has been an explosion really within Little Israel, as we call it, that goes along with the explosion of the rockets. There has been tremendous civil unrest, plain and simple, pogroms in the land of Israel, Arab rioting that has targeted Jews and Jewish communities in mixed cities in particular, but not only. This is something that Regavim has essentially been predicting and trying to prevent for years. And how do we do that? Because we believe that when you fail to enforce the law in something as basic as the question of land use, what you do is create an environment of lawlessness. When you have prejudicial law enforcement, meaning you refuse to enforce the law against the Arab communities within Israel and in Judea and Samaria for political reasons, you end up creating an ex-territoria within your own country. You end up creating the Wild West. You end up with places where the law just doesn't exist in the state of Israel today. And the Israeli government's policy over at least a decade has created the things that have been exploding in the headlines over the past 2 weeks. So this, for example, was the pogrom in Lod. The Jewish community of Lod was targeted. People were attacked. One was killed. People were dragged from their homes. People were assaulted in the streets. Synagogues were burnt down. Jewish schools and religious institutions of other kind were, as you can see, ransacked. And this was clearly a religious war. This was targeting Jews because there were Jews, and particularly religious Jews, but not only. We saw what was happening in the street, and Rigavim could not stand on the sidelines. We got together with My Israel, Sarah Haetzni Cohen, and the members of the Jewish community of Lod, and we created a situation room. This is a picture of Mayor Deutsch, our director general, standing in what was a shul 3 weeks ago. It was completely ransacked, burned to the ground. Everything in it was desecrated, defiled, burnt. We could not stand aside and see this. The police were absent. There was no one on the scene. So you got scenes like, oh, I'm sorry, I thought I had another picture here. So we had Lod in flames, hundreds of cars and businesses and homes of Jews that were completely destroyed, and people who were calling in to the police saying, there are rioters at my door, pounding on my door with metal bars. Someone come and protect us. And they got no answer, to the point where police were possibly returning their calls 24 hours later. This doesn't help when you have a rioting mob outside of your door. So Rigavim, we created first and foremost a bank of phones. We stopped all of our, suspended all of our regular operations, put out a notice on our social media platforms, and volunteers came pouring in to help man the phones and to match up volunteers from all over the country who wanted to go and help the people in mixed cities who were under attack. We asked specifically for people who had training in the army service or otherwise, as medics, officers, people who were armed, people who had skills, who could, who were not afraid to go down and help protect the Jews who were under attack. In addition, we, as you saw here, we purchased protective gear for the volunteers. We purchased fire extinguishers because half of Lod was set up in flames all at once. And we brought people down. They left their homes. They came down to Lod for Shabbat. Some of them also for the Shavuot holiday. They patrolled the streets. They protected people. They protected the elderly who were afraid to stay in their own apartments. And they took the place of law enforcement without taking the law into their own hands. And it's very important for me to stress that Rigavim never, in anything that we do, attempts to replace the institutions of government in the state of Israel. We intend to support the institutions of government. But when the police are completely absent and Jews' lives are being threatened, we felt that the least that we could do was to suspend our regular activities and just bolster the Jewish presence in Lod and help people protect their homes and their property. So
let me just clarify, Naomi, because we just got a question also on the chat about if Israelis are allowed to own firearms. The laws in Israel for owning a gun are draconian. They are incredibly difficult, which might come as a surprise to some people from certain states, let's say in the United States, where it's as easy almost sometimes as buying a chocolate bar. It is very, very difficult to get and to keep a gun license here. But people who do have one can carry. And as you mentioned, the people that were called there were mainly those who had done army service. And so, it's one thing to own a gun. It's another thing to know how to use it and use it correctly. And thank God we have very few accidents with guns. Thank God here in Israel, because really people take it extremely seriously. It's not a toy and everyone knows the power of the weapon. And so that's who you got to go there. And let's remember that this is on the backdrop of what's happening in Gaza. So there are many people in, of course, the southwestern part of Israel who aren't going to leave their homes because their families are sitting in bomb shelters, or who have also been called up for their own army service because some of the reserves were called in. So there was a beautiful film that Ezri Toubi put out last week about you and showing interviewing some of the people who had come for Shabbat, were sleeping on the floor, who from all over Israel, significantly Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria, and who were saying this cannot be allowed to happen. And I know that I felt personally, perhaps you as well, that this was perhaps one of the most disturbing aspects of the last 2 weeks. The Islamic Jihad backed by Iran attacking us from Gaza is unfortunately, it's terrible, but it's not like it's coming as a surprise. The things that happened in Judea and Samaria from the Palestinian Authority and the terrorism, the acts of violence, even on the Temple Mount, which to our great humiliation, the Jews were attacked from the Temple Mount on Jerusalem Day, and then the Jews were barred from praying there while the instigators of the violence were allowed to stay there. And that message was very much understood by the terrorists and by the people who aid and abet them. And of course, just the simple law of tenants who weren't paying their rent and needed to be evacuated from Sheikh Jarrah became like this terrible thing that Israel is destroying Palestinian homes. So, but what really stood out and was incredibly depressing for so many Israelis is, but the Israeli Arabs, the ones who we work so hard to integrate, the ones who live in Lod, the ones who work with us, the ones who go to university with us. And if I'm going to add something very personal here, why did my son go to study medicine in Italy and possibly Amit Biran also? Because there is affirmative action in Israel, and many of the places in medical school in Israel are given to Arabs who are not necessarily deserving of them in order to integrate them and make them feel more Israeli. And what happened here? Why? And this is not, this is a rhetorical question because you don't have the answer and I don't have the answer.
Well, but
this
I have an answer. If you
okay, good. Please.
What Regavim has been saying for many years is that lawlessness in one area breeds lawlessness in all areas. It is no secret. It is well known. As a matter of fact, the Arab members of Knesset are the first to bewail and bemoan and demand action on this particular issue. It is no secret that there is a massive number of illegal firearms in the Arab communities within Israel. Unlicensed guns, you have huge, especially in Lod, you have Arab crime families, you have massive, massive criminal elements in all of these places. And the reason that you have them is because the state of Israel has, for political reasons, declined to enforce the law in various areas. So you have the exact same situation down in the Negev, which is also part of Israel. It's not quote unquote disputed territory. It's little Israel. You have the same thing in the Galilee. You have it all through the Arab communities of Wadi Ara. This is no surprise to anyone who follows any of this. And if you ask the Arab members of Knesset, they will be the first to say the state of Israel must do something about the lawlessness in Arab society. However, they won't support the police when they actually try to do something. So for example, today there were more riots in Lod. You probably won't see that reported anywhere because the police began to use the photographs that we and our volunteers took during the rioting last week and started to arrest people who were involved in all of this. And so the rest of the Arab community in Lod began rioting again today. Now, should the police pull back? We don't want more riots, we want quiet. I'm sorry, that's not the way a modern country can work. It's not the way a democracy should work. A person who was looting, rioting, beating their Jewish neighbors, destroying religious institutions, should not be walking around on the streets. They should be in prison. And that is,
and of course, we're going to add, and it shouldn't even be said, but we're going to anyway, that this goes on both sides, all right? And the few Jews that were also involved in violence against Arabs have also been arrested and will also stand trial. And it must be like that. It absolutely must be like that. So there's no equivalence. There's no equivalence here when it comes to the numbers. And a lot of people like to be spouting that. Well, there's violence on both sides. Okay, let's make it very, very clear that the percentage of violence of Jews against Arabs was minuscule. It doesn't matter. It needs to be stopped. And nobody should be behaving like that from any religion or for any reason. But there is no equivalence here. There weren't Jews going and burning down Umm al-Fahm or, you know, some of the Arab towns. And so, you know, it's clear, but 100%, when there is violence within the Arab towns, which means, of course, that they also have tremendous weapons. So if we turn a blind eye because if an Arab is killing an Arab in an Arab village, okay, that's their own business. But those weapons were turned against Jews and against other people last week. And that's whenever there was a whole hue and cry. But you're 100% right. When there's that environment of, like, you know, just there's villages that we won't go into, then this is what spills out. And exactly, we're paying for this negligence now. Absolutely. And it has to be dealt with.
And we have contended for 15 years since Regavim's establishment, that the failure to enforce land use law, land use policy, building and construction law is the first expression of that lawlessness. Yeah. And that is why, even though the laws that we eventually helped formulate and were eventually put into in force in Israel, they're known as the Kamenetz laws. And I invite anyone who's interested in this to look on our website for a full explanation of what that is. Mm-hmm. But when we finally got these laws in place, the Arab members of Knesset have been fighting them ever since tooth and nail, even though it has these laws have managed to bring down illegal construction starts by 50% every year, another 50% in the 2 years that it's actually been enforced. But the Arab members of Knesset are trying to abolish these laws, trying to repeal them. And why is that? They claim they're racist laws. They apply equally to everyone in the country. The problem is that the practice of illegality in the Arab communities in Israel has become commonplace. It's become standard operating procedure. And that, as we have claimed for 15 years, is what created, what allowed these pockets of exterritorial within Israel to boil over in the last 2 weeks. Something has to be done. We've called for a parliamentary commission of inquiry into the police enforcement in Lod. We've also, we lodged a formal protest against a statement by the chief of police equating violence on the two sides, which, as you said, Eve, is an absolute travesty, and it is a complete falsehood. We went to the area just outside Lod where they towed all of the burnt out cars over the past 2 weeks. And we checked. There's not one single vehicle owned by an Arab in that pound. All of the property that was damaged, all of it belongs to Jews and only Jews. So
I'd just like to make the point that this also comes from my experience serving on the local council in my town for 10 years. There are very many things that are dealt with by the local authorities. And I remember years ago being up in the Galilee, and we were on a tour bus, and somebody said something about the fact that in the Arab villages in the Galilee, they don't have bomb shelters. And of course, the impression that they were trying to leave is that Israel doesn't care about its Arab citizens and therefore doesn't build them bomb shelters. We actually heard that again from, there were two Arabs, a father and daughter, who were killed in one of the rockets from Gaza. They were killed by other Muslims. And the complaint that they had is that their house didn't have a bomb shelter. But it turns out that it's the local authorities very often who were the ones who get the building plans who insist on a bomb shelter or mamad that is being built. And very often in the Arab communities, it's an expensive thing to do, so they waive it. And they say, okay, you don't have to. So, but the impression that's left is that Israel really doesn't care about the Arabs, but there is, within their own society, there's this idea of, you know, you don't need it. But then of course, when they do need it, then Israel is blamed. And this is just one example of many that is, of course, when the news reports it, and I have to add here, and this relates to one of the questions, a very nice question that came up on our chat, is the Israeli news itself is very much to blame for the impressions that people get. Very much slanted to one view and doesn't make Israel's life easier. So I know we blame the Israeli government, and we should, and there are a lot of things that aren't done, but part of the blame definitely resides with those who are reporting on the news from Israel, and of course, outside of Israel, who don't report all the truth, or definitely don't report it in context. And that's something that really, those of you who are listening need to make sure that you're getting your news from reputable places. Because despite ourselves, we get influenced. And it's very, very important to be armed with the truth and to make sure that your news is coming from the places that you know are giving it in context, not lying, giving out the truth, but giving the whole story and not just part of it.
Eve, I'm so glad that you brought that up. And I'm even gladder that you mentioned the two Arab fatalities that you did. I'd like to just discuss that for a moment, because that will really spotlight exactly what the problem is here. The father and daughter who were killed are residents of a place known as Dahamash. Dahamash is between Lod and Ramle. Dahamash is an illegal squatters camp. And that is why it has no bomb shelters, because those people shouldn't be living there. Regavim went to the courts years ago, to have the residents of Dahamash removed. They were squatting on land that is slated for a railroad to connect outlying peripheral communities to the center of the country. But the country cannot develop its own infrastructure because these people are sitting, squatting, building illegally, without permits, without planning, and therefore without proper electricity lines, without proper running water, without proper sewage, and tragically, without bomb shelters.
Mm-hmm.
These people's lives were taken because of the lawlessness and the failure of the state of Israel to enforce the law. It's not that they did them any big favor by not evacuating them from their illegal squatters camp. And this is what we have contended for years. The law is there to protect you. The law is there to protect individuals, and it's there to protect the future of this country as a whole. If we want sustainable growth, if we want logical planning, if we want to be able to grow, develop, and have some place for our children and grandchildren to live as decent, a decent standard of living with clean water and clean air, we cannot allow people simply to build wherever they want and then demand from the state to supply them with all the services that they've come to expect from a modern democratic society. It doesn't work that way. The exact same thing is happening in the Negev, where some 70% of Israel's available land reserves are in the Negev. There's almost nowhere else for us to grow, to build, to develop. But we can't do that because people are squatting illegally all over the Negev and then demanding that the state of Israel provide them with services to each of these far-flung and completely illogical and unplanned squatters' communities. So this is what Regavim has been doing for 15 years, trying to get the government to act against this lawlessness, trying to enforce, to create and enforce some sort of forward-thinking, rational land use policy, and along the way, to exert its sovereignty, to establish its sovereignty, and to protect the lives and well-being of every person in this country.
So there is so much to talk about, but I want to get back to the, at least the advertised topic of tonight's tonight's talk. Of course, when we decided on this webinar, we didn't know like all the craziness that was going to happen in the last couple of weeks that we would want to talk about. Who thought that synagogues would be burnt in Lod? I mean, it was just beyond. But if you're describing really eloquently how the government has failed in keeping the laws within the sovereign state of Israel, then how on earth can we expect it to do it in the area of Judea and Samaria where Israel does not have sovereignty, where essentially it is by military law? I mean, people talk about the occupation. The fact is here, I live in Efrat in Gush Etzion. I technically live under military law because the Jewish, the Israeli civil law doesn't apply here. So we talk about what's happening in Judea Samaria, the tremendous growth of building here that's funded by the EU, which is a topic I would really like to delve in with you. The tremendous destruction of archaeological sites that we're seeing with impunity, and that cannot be brought back. Once a site is dug up, all the layers are mixed up. You know, you might find some pottery shards or something, but the being able to date it, which is so incredibly important for archaeology, and not just Jewish archaeology. There are virtually every civilization was here at one point or the other. And we want to expose all of that. And that we're seeing all over is being destroyed every single day. And nothing is being done about that. So can we get to that focus of Judea and Samaria. And I know Regavim works 25-hour days in order to bring this and with victories. I mean, with really some very, even with Israel's court system that is not leaning right, shall we say, in any stretch of the imagination. You've gotten victories in the court system, and then what happens?
Yes. So I don't know how much of this, I don't really have time to give people enough of a background. I'm hoping that most of the viewers today have enough of a background to understand what the system is that's currently in place and has been in place for 53 years in Judea and Samaria.
That's beyond the scope of today's show.
Beyond
yes.
the scope, but what I will say is, no matter what you hear, and just because it's repeated over and over doesn't make it true, the state of Israel is not an occupier in Judea and Samaria. The state of Israel, under international law, has every right to build communities. It actually has a responsibility to build communities in Judea and Samaria, to issue building permits, and to create a normal situation for healthy life and development in these areas, even if it is not a sovereign there. And the problem is that the state of Israel has failed to do so, has failed to use the tools that are available to it under international law and under the Oslo Accords, which is now international law, being that an international treaty that has signed and has never been has never been replaced by something else, is the law. So the Oslo Accords are essentially the law of the land right now, and the state of Israel is failing to enforce those laws. It is behaving towards the Jewish communities of the of this entire region as if the Oslo Accords are the letter of the law, and it is behaving as if towards the non-Jewish communities as if the Oslo Accords are no longer in force. You can't play a one-sided game. So I'm just going to skip through all of this, and I'm going to look quickly with everyone at this map. This is the map that was created by the Oslo Accords. The different colors here illustrate who's in charge where. So as you can see, the red and dark maroon areas are under full Palestinian Authority civilian control. That means that the people who live there don't ever have to come into contact with the state of Israel or Israeli authorities, and the Palestinian Authority is in charge of everything there and has full responsibility for the lives, education, health, welfare of the people living there. The yellow area is Area C, some 60% of Judea and Samaria, and that is where Israel has full jurisdiction. And this is what the map should look like. Since the Oslo Accords, this is what the map should look like. Unfortunately, this is what the map really looks like. Those purple dots are all what we have found when we go out on out in the field every day. Those are all illegal Palestinian Authority outposts in the areas under full Israeli jurisdiction. Now you'll note that they aren't haphazard. You'll note that they're all concentrated in a very, very strategic sort of layout. There are none of them over here. There are none of them over here. There are none of them over here. There are also none of them over here. And there are none of them in the red areas. They're here for a reason. They're here because the Palestinian Authority put them there. How did they put them there? When did they put them there? Who's helping them put them there, and to what end, is what I want to try to discuss very, very quickly this evening. This is the cover of the Fayyad plan. The Fayyad plan, the man that you see on the right-hand side of the screen, is Salam Fayyad. He was the Prime Minister of the Palestinian Authority. And in 2009, only 4 years after Israel ceded the last inch of territory that it was required to do under the Oslo Accords, 4 years later, Salam Fayyad, Prime Minister of the Palestinian Authority, announced that the Oslo Accords were finished and would not help them achieve the state they wanted to achieve. And therefore, they were going to change direction altogether and begin de facto building the Palestinian state, specifically in Area C. Because Areas A and B were already under full Palestinian jurisdiction, they were going to focus all of their efforts on Area C, which is exactly what we saw that they are, doing with these purple dots. So in 2009, they made this announcement. Almost immediately, they received the support of a very, very important partner who has partnered with them ever since, and that is the European Union. So here, for example, is in 2010, only a year later, in announcing its national development plan for the following 3-year cycle, the European Union and the Palestinian Authority are now actively participating in the planning and zoning of Area C, which will pave the way for development and more authority of the Palestinian Authority over Area C. And from that time onward, the European Union has never hidden the fact that it is helping the Palestinian Authority, they call it prepare for statehood, we call it creating a de facto state in Area C.
Now, it must be noted that this is against internationally signed agreements.
Absolutely.
This isn't just like a group, kind of an NGO helping some people to put in better running water and paved sidewalks.
The European Union is a signatory and a witness to the Oslo Accords. It's not as if they don't know what's in there, and it's not as if they have any question about what their role is supposed to be. If the European Union were really interested in helping the Palestinian Authority prepare for statehood, it would insist on A, controlling the curriculum and stopping the education to hate, B, creating infrastructure and developing the areas already under Palestinian Authority control, areas A and B, C, returning to the negotiating table and giving them incentives to do so rather than giving them incentives not to do so. And as we're going to see in the following photos, they have given them, the European Union's assistance has given the Palestinian Authority every reason not to negotiate with Israel. They are simply handing them the Palestinian state on a silver platter and completely circumventing negotiation or compromise with the state of Israel in any way. And the state of Israel, for its part, is doing absolutely nothing or has done absolutely nothing to stop this process.
And that is there was a devastating report that came out about a month ago. I interviewed somebody, but I couldn't say who it was on my podcast about it, an organization called Ad Kan that went undercover with cameras and had meetings with people high up in the EU who talked very openly about what they're doing, that they're helping the Palestinian Authority with master plans and giving them tremendous amounts of money to build and to build and to build. We're talking like €1 billion, and that their next plan is to surround Jerusalem. But my question, we're going to keep coming back to this, and I don't know if you have the answer, is how is this being allowed to happen? This isn't like some underground tunnels, let's say, that even Israel found out about, right, in Gaza. These are paved roads. These are large buildings. These are cities. This is piping going down. It is a tremendous amount of infrastructure that's happening in front of all of our faces. We see it, those of us who live here see it every single day. You're talking about over a decade of a Netanyahu so-called right-wing government. What is going on?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's exactly what I'd like to discuss. First, I fast forwarded to this map because several years ago, we at Regavi mapped out the places, among these illegal outposts, we mapped out the places where there is clear, declared European Union intervention. And I'm not talking about intervention on, you know, they come to visit once in a while. I'm talking about, for example, this sort of thing, where over 80% of the structures in each of these outposts bear the EU symbol. I'll show them to you up close. That means that the European Union created these illegal outposts. They wouldn't be there without the European Union making them and placing them there. And we mapped out where some of the most egregious examples are. And you can see they're not about to start circling Jerusalem. They've been at it for over a decade. All of these illegal outposts, these green dots, are choking Jerusalem and cutting off Jerusalem, both from its eastern border, from the Dead Sea, and cutting, this is literally bisects the country, both north, south, and east, west. Mm-hmm. And they have a huge concentration here. So when you travel from Jerusalem towards Maale Adumim, you see dozens of these outposts. And some of those are the ones that I'll show you close-up pictures of today. Some of them are some of the most famous cases that you'll read about in the newspaper, and something that you referenced also, Eve. The most famous, the flagship, the one that we took to court 13 years ago, is called Khan al-Ahmar, where we had six separate rounds of Supreme Court victories. The Supreme Court agreed with our proof that that the outpost is illegal, the people who are living there should not be there, and they should be removed. What you see here is Maale Adumim, and what you see here are all these outposts choking it. Mm-hmm. An old picture. There's some video footage here. We took some drone photos so that you could get a better perspective of how much of this there is. This is actually also going back a few years. Things are much more developed already, right, by now.
There's already real buildings and apartment buildings that we see, especially around Jerusalem.
There are wind turbines now. They're full of solar panels. It's much more established now, but this is what we submitted to the court to give the court an idea of what it is that we're talking about. So they're all over. This is all along Route 1, the main highway that connects Jerusalem to the Dead Sea. Sorry, going back again. This is along Route 60, where you see the same thing, Route 60 being the main ancient highway that serves all of the communities of Judea and Samaria. Look at how close to the road they are. Again, as you said, Eve, this is not some small thing that happens in the dead of night and nobody notices, and then you wake up in the morning and there it is. This has been going on for years. Now, someone had asked, had submitted a question before we began today to ask, who's doing this? Who are the ones who are taking over? And that is something that I can show you very, very clearly. It is incredibly sad. It is incredibly cynical. And I just want to stress before I show any other photos, we at Rigavim, and I don't think anyone, no person who lives in Judea and Samaria or Israel as a whole, has anything against the people who are living here. That is not the issue. We don't consider them our enemies. We consider them unfortunate pawns in a very much larger political game.
I'm going to actually take issue with that because I know some of what goes on in these places. There's a lot of drug smuggling. There's a lot of weapon smuggling. There's a lot of things there that, let's just say, don't add to the fabric of society. They're not just innocent shepherds who were paid to squat.
Down in the Negev, those problems are much greater. And those are Arab Bedouin citizens of Israel. So that's a subject for another day. But illegal quarrying is scarring the countryside. That's another whole issue that we deal with. But there are several tactics that the Palestinian Authority uses. And it uses these people, Bedouin, for two very, very simple reasons. And the reason they use them and the way that they use them is extremely simple and extremely brilliant. And Salam Fayyad announced this in 2009. What he said was, the Bedouin are the foot soldiers for Palestinian independence. And what you see here is the main tool for territorial takeover in the E1 area. It looks very, very innocent. What it is a water tanker. Because Bedouin move from place to place with the seasons for one reason and one reason only, and that is for water sources. When the water runs out at the end of a season, they move someplace further south or further north or further east or further west in search of water sources, and they have their traditional route which takes them along water sources. So what the Palestinian Authority did all through Judea and Samaria is they placed water tankers at strategic spots that they had already mapped out for takeover. They put a water tanker there and went away. That's all they had to do. The Bedouin collected around this water tanker, and once a week, the Palestinian Authority came and switched the water tanker, an empty one, for a full one, and the Bedouin stayed. And more Bedouin collected around these spots, and hey presto, in a month, you have a new community. An ancient historic village. They give it a name, they give it a whole narrative, and it's a fact on the ground. So that's how the Bedouin are used as the foot soldiers for Palestinian independence.
But Naomi, I'm gonna play devil's advocate here for a second. It's a question that was sent to me a few days ago. Somebody's saying, well, what's the difference between the Hilltop Youth, right? You have certain places in Judea and Samaria where you have mainly young kids who sit and squat on a mountaintop in some tents, and get unfortunately a very bad name. Most of them are really just kids who need some guidance. Some of them need more than just guidance. They need a social worker or sometimes even a stint in jail. But in the main, the question was, so what's the difference? I mean, you've got it on the Israeli side and you got it on the Palestinian side. It's a big land grab.
I'm hoping that I'm not going to make you dizzy because I'm going to flip all the way through to one of the last slides that I brought to show you today, just to show you graphically what the difference is. And here's the difference. When you start out with a Bedouin outpost, you end up with this. Hilltop Youth don't build this. They don't build this. They don't build this. They don't build this. And I'm gonna come back to all these pictures because when I show you where they are, you will be shocked. Sorry, that's a bad picture of me. This is Khan al-Ahmar, by the way, 2 years ago. Today, it is almost tripled in size. But Khan al-Ahmar, again, what's the difference between the Bedouin and the Hilltop Youth? I'm gonna show you in a second. So aside from all of this international support, I want you to look at this map if you can. This is the same map that we looked at before. Areas A, B are in red and maroon. Area C is the gray. The green are IDF firing zones and or nature reserves. Look carefully. See the blue dots? The blue dots are the sum total of Jewish settlement in Judea and Samaria. You have to look really hard because Jewish settlement in all of Judea and Samaria, the thing that brings us international condemnation and tens of thousands of scathing articles in the international press every year, that's what it is. It is less than 1% of the total of Judea and Samaria's area. And if you count only Area C, the area under Israeli jurisdiction, it's less than 2%. That's the difference. Now look again and you'll see where the Palestinians are building illegally. And they have far, far overtaken us. Here's the blue dots again. I removed all the other stuff so you could see it a little better. The red dots are illegal Palestinian construction. The blue dots are legal, illegal Jewish settlement of all kinds. That includes Hilltop Youth, that includes Efrat, that includes where I live, Givat Zev, that includes Ariel, that includes everywhere that Jews live. And it's less than 1%.
So what? One of the things that came out from the interview that I did with Ad Khan, and it's something that many of us here already know, but I want the listeners to hear this. The organization that it's in charge of Judea and Samaria is called the Civil Administration. They're the ones who are in charge of all the planning and every house that gets built and every balcony that gets closed in. The Civil Administration was actually set up after 1967 to protect the Arab rights in Judea and Samaria and not the Jews. And right. It became very clear from that undercover survey that they had, if you will, of the EU, that the Civil Administration is actually working quite closely with the EU in making sure that the Arab building plans are maybe not given a stamp of approval, but are definitely not stopped and not taken down. And so I'm going to be obnoxious and come back to this question again. Why, Naomi? And it's fine if you don't have the answer, because I haven't found anybody yet who will give me an answer. Is with all, with the army and with the tools at our disposal and with the legal ability and stamp of approval, even from the very left-wing Israeli Supreme Court, why in 2021 is this being allowed to happen?
So the answer is one word, but that one word needs to be explained. The answer is pressure. There's two kinds of pressure that are exerted on Israel. The major pressure is from outside, but coming in at a very close second is the internal pressure. The state of Israel, the people of Israel, are divided on this question. Everyone in Israel, you, me, people who work for the civil administration, people who live in Tel Aviv, people who are considered Hilltop Youth, everyone wants peace. The question is, how do you achieve it? There are some people who believe that this Israeli, the 2% of the territory of Area C that is covered in Jewish settlement, is why we don't have peace. And there are others, like me, who believe that the reason we don't have peace is because of the other 98% of Judea and Samaria that doesn't have Jewish communities on it. Now, you can argue and you can say one or the other, but the state of Israel has been unwilling to force a resolution of that question. And if anyone's interested, I actually debated, I had an interview, it wasn't really an interview, it was practically fisticuffs, but over Zoom, with the spokesperson for the European Union about 2 weeks ago. And he said, well, you know, the European Union is a collection of 27 democratic, mature democracies. And if we say that this is the best way, then I trust our judgment a lot more than I trust yours. Well, I disagree. I told him that I believe that that is colonialist and that it is condescending and that the state of Israel doesn't have to apologize, not to Europe for sure, about deciding what is in our best interest. And we will decide what is in our best interest. On the other hand, the government of Israel has been unwilling to face off with the 27 European countries that are members of the European Union and who are doing this, which is why little annoying NGOs like Regavim have to force them to explain themselves. The government of Israel has to be forced to explain that it is kowtowing to European pressure. At the same time, we also approach the European Union. I went to Brussels, I spoke to members of parliament. We have members of the European Parliament, when I showed them where their quote unquote humanitarian aid was going to build illegal structures that are making a negotiated resolution to the conflict impossible, not just unlikely, but impossible, they were shocked because there are interests here that are far bigger that are giving them false information. The Palestinian Authority says to them, we need humanitarian aid, we're in terrible humanitarian crisis. So the Europeans pay, and they pay tens of millions, hundreds of millions. And where does that money go? Here's another map. We had a close look. We had a close look at where the money is going, where things are being developed and where they aren't. Areas A and B that are under full Palestinian Authority jurisdiction, where they don't need any Israeli permission to build, to develop, to make life more livable for their own citizens, are empty. Over 70% of available land reserves in areas A and B are empty. But all of the money that the Europeans give to the Palestinian Authority is poured into illegal projects, specifically in areas under Israeli jurisdiction, because the Palestinian Authority is doing exactly what they said they were going to do. And that is using every possible resource at their disposal to create the Palestinian state in Area C. The state of Israel has to stand up like an adult democracy and take responsibility. And what we try to do is force them to do that.
And perhaps we'll have some kind of government within a short amount of time who will actually do that. And doesn't have to stand, as we said, on ideology, can just waive internationally signed agreements and say, we're a law-abiding state, and therefore we're going to follow the letter of the law. And this is illegal, because this is incredibly upsetting. I didn't sleep after watching the undercover. I didn't sleep for like 2 days. Because it's one thing to feel that we know who our enemies are, and it's another thing to feel that the state is not protecting its citizens in the way that it should. And with all due respect to Iron Dome and all the wonderful, incredible soldiers that we have and the intelligence systems that we have that make James Bond look like a cartoon, from what I understand, there's a major fail here. And it's beyond the purview of tonight's webinar to talk about the other factors that are playing in here. This is not just a Hatfield and McCoy Palestinians in Israel. There's Iran out there, and they're the ones who are funding Hamas. There's the fact that the Palestinian Authority is not having elections as they said that they would. And that's what threw a lot of the region, and Hamas has to show that it's more powerful than the Palestinian Authority. There's a lot of internal things happening here that almost have nothing to do with Israel, between the Sunnis and the Shias and the Saudis, and a lot of things happening in this region. And you can throw in China and Russia and the new administration in America. Okay, there's a very big mess here. But the easiest thing to do is to attack Israel and to undermine Israel and kind of deflect attention from the much bigger picture that really almost has nothing to do with Israel at all, that has to do with a whole lot of people. And this is really my concern. We're not just talking about a couple of illegal shacks and some water. So fine, they have goats, they have sheep, so give them some shacks. What's the difference? There wasn't a Jewish community there anyway.
So let me show you something.
It's imperative to understand the bigger picture here.
Mm-hmm. I want to leave everyone with just some images. Now, again, look at the date. We took this in 2016. It's quite some time ago. This started out, what you're looking at is footage that we filmed in an IDF training ground, 917, which is back to back with the Jewish communities of the southern Hebron area, Carmel, mm-hmm. Maon, Abigail. This started out with a few Bedouin tents, the same as what we saw in the E1 area. But in 2016, this is already what it looked like. And I can tell you that since 2016, it has doubled in size. So I'm just going to run this. It was taken from a dash cam. We drive through there. Do these look like little tents anymore?
No.
The road here was recently completely refurbished, paid for by the United Kingdom. Hundreds of thousands of pounds went into redoing this road. Notice the electrical poles. Electricity is brought in from Yatta. notice again the water tankers that we passed by. You'll see more of them if you look quickly. We're not talking about tents and little squatters camps anymore. This is a massive city built on an IDF training ground, back to back with Jewish communities in an area that connects, that sits on the smuggling routes, which is what you had referenced before, Eve, sits on the smuggling routes that connect the smugglers coming up from Gaza through the Negev into Israel proper. From here, they've connected an extremely hostile Hamas-controlled town called Bani Naim all the way down. We drove on the smugglers' road. We took a journalist from Yediot Ahronot with a plastic machine gun on his lap, and we drove from here straight down to Dimona. These smuggling routes are used for drugs, for arms, for smuggling human trafficking, women, for the entire practice of polygamy, which is a different issue. But look carefully. These are not little shacks. When you don't clear a little shack like Khan al-Ahmar off of the ground where they're squatting, you end up with a massive city controlled by smuggling clans of Bedouin with connections from Gaza through the Negev and all the way up into Israel proper. The state of Israel has fallen asleep on its watch here. And this city
we could talk about so many different issues for so long. I want to go to some of the questions that some of the people watching, some of the viewers and listeners have sent in. Some are really excellent, and I'd like to get to a few of them. Some I'll answer, some I'll throw to you. Jay Lewis asking, will all this negatively impact future waves of tourism or immigration? Will people think twice about visiting or moving to Israel if it's considered an unsafe country? And so I'm going to answer not just as a tour guide, but as an Israeli, someone who's lived here for a long time. You're part of the solution. And that is the answer. It's not so safe to be Jewish anywhere in the world right now. And Israel should be the safest place. And if it's not right now, then what we need is more Jews here. What we need is more dedicated Jews here, more Jews who understand laws and who will vote in a certain way in order to change the direction that the country is going in. When you love something, when you really love something, you get in there and you make it better. Okay, I'm probably not the only one who didn't have perfect children, and sometimes kids need therapy, physical, emotional, whatever it is. You love your child, you get the best help that they possibly can have. Israel needs help. Israel is not a perfect place. We are an incredible place, but we are still in formation. And there are a lot of pressures, as Naomi said, from different countries in the world. And let's say it flat out, there's a lot of anti-Semitism out there. And there are a lot of people in the world, maybe even most, and I'm going to talk about the Western world here, who couldn't care less if Israel was wiped out completely. And the way to answer that, and you don't have to be a believing Jew or in any other way, is to come and make a difference and to change it yourselves. We're not building a perfect country for people to make aliyah to and say, wow, the falafel is amazing and this is all just perfect. All right, you need to come here and do what I did and do what Naomi did and roll up your sleeves and get busy to make it the country that we know we deserve to have. The potential is all there. It's all in the people, but we need you here to make it happen. All right, and I'm saying it really from the bottom of my heart.
That is the answer. I encourage all of you to just do a very simple Google search. How many Jews were there in this country in 1948? How many Jews were there in this country in 1967? And how many Jews
and
are
do the math.
Do the math.
And do the every math and come single, make a difference.
Every single person makes a difference.
More than just one difference. We really punch above our weight here. And I know I speak for myself and for Naomi as well. We've had this conversation off Zoom that we never expected to be doing what we're doing. And you just need to come. And someone wants to know how they can help Regavim. Be in touch with me afterwards. One Israel Fund and Regavim work together. And we're very happy to help you with a donation over to Regavim. A question about Bibi is part of the problem. I'm going to skip that. I think it's pretty clear where we're going with that. News sources, write to me, eve@oneisraelfund.org, and I will give you a list of the news sources. Obviously, the best ones are in Hebrew, but there are some in English that you can trust as well, and that is super important to remember. Okay, that's a few of this. Why the Israeli people are taking this lying down? We're not, and there is outrage, but we're not going to go out and demonstrate against the Israeli government when there's rockets coming in from Gaza and Jews being beaten up in Lod. There's a limit as to, this has to be a certain sensitivity here also to what is happening around us and to the amount of energy that we have. And
I'd like to add to that, if I may. Regavim works to support the government, to empower the government, exactly, to energize the government.
The government is us.
We are the government.
Democracy.
Correct. And it doesn't matter what government is there, we're going to work with them to make it the best government for for all of us that we can. So, and that's the only way. So I will not take any questions about politicians or politics for that reason. We will work with whoever is out there. I've put up on the screen now just a snapshot from the homepage of Regavim's website. If you're interested, we now put out a monthly update of what we're up to, what's on the agenda. So you can go onto our website, and at the bottom of the homepage, you'll just put in your email and you can get monthly updates about our activities. Also, our website is a tremendous resource. All of our legal work is there. It's updated on a daily basis, but it also has all of our position papers, all of the maps, all the photos.
Absolutely. A lot of the work that you've been doing. There is, Mark Karaf asked an excellent question, that the European Union is divided on this issue. And I think that that's a very important point to make. And during the kerfluffle that we had from Gaza in the last few days, there were countries in Eastern Europe, Austria, if I'm not mistaken, who were flying the Israeli flag, who were very, very clear that they stand with Israel. And I think that is important. There are divisions within the EU that can be worked on as well. It's not a monolithic body. It's got plenty of problems of its own. And look, a lot of it is who's powerful. If Israel is powerful and serves their needs, then maybe they will be more pro-Israel. The question is what serving their needs means. If they understand that we're the bulwark against Iran and against the jihadist Islam, that's not just gunning for Israel, but it's gunning for everybody, okay? And you just look no farther than the United States Congress to see how certain people and certain elements have infiltrated into the American government as well and are undermining the United States to understand who the good guys are and who the bad guys are and how we have to work together. All right, so I think
add to that very, very briefly that I work very hard on garnering support among members of the European Parliament. And we have, I've traveled to Brussels, I have met with MEPs. There's an important group of members of the European Parliament who are listening. We now have some who are submitting official queries to the European Council about funding for terrorism-related organizations here in Israel. We are making progress. The more support they understand we have, the more they're inclined to support our issues, and the more they will know that their constituents in their home countries are behind them as well. They want to be on the right side. They just don't necessarily know what the right side is, and that's our job, to make them know what the truth is, and to give them the tools to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. And of course, as soon as you can, you come here. I know you want to, so I'm running through an open door. You come here, you make sure to come to Judea and Samaria, to come to these places, to educate yourselves about what's happening here, to be outraged. I mean, I think this webinar definitely spurred some outrage, but to really see for yourselves, get the facts on the ground. Many of you know people in high places. Some people are just going to be against Israel and Jews no matter what we do. And they're just a waste of time. But there are people, there are very, very good people who are just ignorant or getting the wrong messaging or getting the wrong information. And that's something that every single one of us can do and to make sure that, you know, if you're not on the side of the good guys, you are on the side of the bad guys. It really is that simple. Then you're aiding and abetting evil. And we just have to make sure all of us it's easy to get frustrated, to throw the newspaper at the television or whatever it is that we do these days. And we can't do it. None of us can do it. And this is really our mandate. We talk about, you know, as the Jewish people being the light into the nations, we have to call out what's wrong. And no matter where it is, and here things are wrong. And we have to make sure that we stand up. And that changes who we are and will change the country. It already has, as Naomi said. Look at the difference what's happened here in the last 100 years. It's unbelievable. It really is unbelievable. What a magnificent country this is, but we have more to do. And sometimes we take a step backwards or sometimes sideways. And we all need to be involved. So be involved with Regavim. please be involved with an Israel fund, be in touch with me, be in touch with Naomi, and whatever you can do is deeply appreciated and all part of a very, very big battle that we're all waging. And it's very frightening. I know a lot of us, the scenes of the last couple of weeks, not just here in Israel, but in New York and in other in London and places around the world where you can't walk down the sidewalk anymore with a kippah on. How can that possibly be? If the survivors of the Holocaust are still walking around, they're still alive and we're back to this, how can this possibly be? So we have to do whatever we can, whether it's in Israel or not in Israel, to put a stop to it. And if it means that we have to push our own government and not give them a choice, then that's what we're going to have to do. That's our mandate to do it. That's what happens in a democracy. The people do get a voice. And you're part of that as well, even if you're not here. So I want to thank Naomi so much for joining us this evening and really sharing a lot of what Regavim does, the very important work that we